That's what I call stuff in the ring. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're live. We're back on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in. Had some technical difficulties, but we got it. We're here. We're live. St. Xavier University in Chicago with Dr. Jacqueline Battalora. Say hi, everybody.
Hi.
Yay. This is awesome. As you know, for the viewers out there watching, Dr. Battalora is an attorney and professor of sociology and criminal justice at St. Xavier University in Chicago, my hometown, my cold, cold hometown. She's an anti-racist writer, educator, and trainer. She teaches courses in law and society. She's also a former Chicago police officer and author of Birth of a White Nation, The Invention of White People, and its relevance today. This is historic because the students, her students, are going to be talking about and challenging institutionalized racism and white supremacy. Welcome back, Doc.
All right, great to be here. Thanks for having us, and thank you for inviting my students.
Absolutely. This is so cool.
It is cool. We're really happy to be here.
So
let me just share with your listeners the framework of the class so they have a context for making sense of these projects. The course is a sociology class called Invention of Race.
Okay.
And, you know, we spent the first third of the class, probably a little more, just building up our historical knowledge. We began with information from my book, which covers the legal invention of this group of humanity called white people. Mm-hmm. Then we went into the institutionalization of that invention in the founding laws of the United States of America. And then we moved from there into this idea of white people become and non-white people all becoming something that we now call race, which of course occurred in the 20th century. So we covered that history really ad nauseum. You could ask any one of these people anything and they could answer it for you. And then we shifted from that history to exploring our internal relationship to whiteness, to institutionalized white superiority. Everybody wrote a whiteness biography, exploring that. And the third part of the class is what we're hoping to share, at least some of which we're hoping to share with y'all today.
And I don't know what's happening with the, hold on, not to interrupt you, but you look like you're on a cruise ship and the ship is about to turn over.
Oh, you know
like what? Nobody's going to make it. You're on the Titanic. Okay, there we go. Because I'm slowly doing this as I'm listening to him like, hey, oh, wait a minute. Got to stabilize people. Okay, here we go.
All right. All right. Welcome to the Invention of Race cruise line.
Now your students are cut off, so let's take the thing back down. All right, there we go. There, now that's the best shot we've had. Okay, great.
Awesome. Okay, so
no pressure.
So what I'm excited to share with folks and with you, Philippe, are some of the products of their efforts in these projects.
Mm-hmm.
And so the first group that I'm going to have come up here, they had a particular interest in. They were concerned in light of the fact that most picture books that we have of famous people who are part of the American narrative, including people we celebrate with holidays, that it's not a truthful story. And so they wanted to try to tackle some of that as early as possible in our kids' education. And so they put together a book on Christopher Columbus to tell a better story. And they targeted 5 and 6-year-olds. So I'm gonna have them come up and I'm gonna hold things up, hopefully for viewers to see page by page as they read it. Then we'll move on to the next project, which shifts.
That there is a universal sign for get over here.
Yeah, get over here. All right, so come on over. You have to come stand here.
I can turn it towards them. They want to stand over there.
Okay. And are you home? Okay, let's go.
And who do we have? We need names.
You guys just all want to stand over there, and we can get like a full shot.
You're good.
You're there.
Okay. Hi. What's your name?
Introduce yourself.
Hi,
introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Jessica Salgado.
Hi, my name is Stephanie Reyes.
I'm Andrea Lopez.
And I'm Crystal Garcia.
Wonderful. What do you guys got?
A children's book about Christopher Columbus.
Okay.
Hold it up and let's who's gonna read.
Okay, so the title, The Untold Story of Christopher Columbus. And we have a little brief introduction. In elementary school, children establish basic foundations of understanding. It is a perfect time for them to understand truths about history in developmentally appropriate ways. In order to promote equity through children's literature, there must be a transition from books that present the perceptive of the conquered to the framework that is a better representation of the U.S. population and shapes a more complete history. Christopher Columbus was born in Genoa, Italy. The King and Queen of Spain paid Christopher Columbus to sail the ocean blue. On October 12, 1492, Christopher Columbus thought he landed in the West Indies.
He really landed in the present-day Bahamas. Since Columbus thought he landed in the West Indies, he called the Native Americans Indians. Christopher Columbus is known for discovering America, but there were Native American people already living there. And Christopher Columbus brought horses, cows, and much more to the land that he thought he discovered.
On his way back to Spain, Christopher Columbus brought back the little treasures that he took. But did you know? Christopher Columbus and his people also brought germs with them. Sadly, more than half of the Native American population could not survive the harmful germs. Christopher Columbus also captured some of the Native Americans that were left. On his way back to Spain, Christopher Columbus brought back the little treasures that he took.
Christopher Columbus took some of the Native Americans back to Spain against their will. Americans back to Spain against their will and forced them to work. Although Christopher Columbus brought some good news to the Americas, he made bad choices with how he treated the Native Americans. At the end, we decided to create some reflection questions that teachers could possibly use for the children. And our first question was, what does it mean to do something against your will? Do you think it is okay to take some things from others? How could he have been nicer to Native Americans? And that's how we decided to finish our book.
Nicely.
Yep.
Thank you.
That's what I said.
I'm buying the first copy.
Yep.
I will write the forward to that one. That is absolutely necessary for our children. That's talk about changing the narrative. That is huge. Thank you for that.
Yes, thank you all.
And give yourselves a round of applause for that. That is awesome.
And so another group had a similar concern, and that was with regard to the versions of American history that we celebrate. And they produced a brief historical overview of racially biased American figures.
Mm-hmm.
So what they did was they tackled just 9 people that we generally celebrate. It goes from George Washington, includes Abraham Lincoln, President Jackson, Elvis Presley, and Walt Disney.
Wow. You guys are not, you guys are serious. Don't go after Elvis. Oh, my God.
Yeah, even Elvis. And so.
Oh, wow, that's huge.
So what they've done is they collected some sort of a few points of historical information that we all tend to learn about these figures.
Mm-hmm.
But then they included, because, right, the version of history that we tend to learn, especially about particular individuals that we designate as important, is we really learn sort of a caricature of them.
Mm-hmm.
It's one-dimensional portrayal of a human being. And of course, conveniently, when it comes to white people who are Americans, it's only the good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And there is not a human in existence who isn't far more complex than that. We all make mistakes. We've all done things we wish we could change. So what they've done is really highlighted the investment that these historical figures have had in white superiority. And
wow.
So they want to fold that into the historical narrative just to help us learn. To again present these figures as far more complex.
That's incredible. This speaks to the cognitive dissonance that we have discussed on previous shows. Mm-hmm. That's a beautiful case. Where can one get that?
Yeah, I knew that was coming. So I tell you what we're gonna do is I'll provide my email address at the end.
Okay.
And then if anybody wants anything, information about some of the projects, how we went about it, actually wanting some of these documents, I'll send those requests to the different parties who produce them and let them handle dispersing the information. Is that all right?
Fantastic.
All right. Fantastic.
So I'll be the first one.
All right. Great. Okay, so then we had groups that tried to tackle implicit bias and stereotypes.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I'd like to do is have the group that dealt with stereotypes in spoken word to come on up. And no, you guys, yeah. I think while they're coming up, I'll go ahead and provide some of the basis of their presentation. What they did was they recorded three individuals reading, was it a poem?
Yeah. Yeah.
The same poem.
It's a short thing.
Just a very short thing. Can we play it?
We have to...
That's okay.
I have it on my laptop.
So, and then they asked people to, they put headphones on participants and asked them to identify the race of the speaker. And so it was a chance for people to sort of reflect upon our assumptions about race. And spoken word. And of course, what they didn't tell participants is that all of the speakers were persons of African descent.
Mm.
Right, and so, here, come on up. Let's see if we can capture visually just a little.
So the first speaker, most participants, should we introduce ourselves?
Please, yes.
So I'm Amanda.
Hi, Amanda.
I'm Caitlin.
I can't see you, Amanda. Okay. Get busy. Okay. Who's the cameraman?
Gotta go.
So, most...
Introduce yourselves.
I'm Caitlin.
and Amanda. Okay.
What am I doing?
So most of the people who stopped by and listened to the free recordings... They mostly thought, I think all of them thought mm-hmm. that the first person here was white. But as you can see, again, African descent. People were pretty surprised by that. And then we were like, look at speaker two. Again, also of African descent. Some people actually thought he was Hispanic, but he got kind of a mix of responses. And then speaker three was also of African descent. And that was the one we used him to kind of
play into the stereotype.
Yes, yeah, exactly. So most people did think that he was of African descent. But our project was received pretty well. There was one teacher who went through it all and then was like, "This is awesome!" Gave us high fives. Some people were kind of hesitant, understandably, when we asked them if they could racially identify them. Which, again, understandable, but...
Right, I thought this project did a really nice job of really putting in your face
sure.
our own assumptions, right? Because here's one important sort of lesson that we've talked about in this class quite a bit, and I think their project helped us to see that, is when somebody is surprised, when you evoke surprise, usually that's because you've tapped into somebody's stereotype, right? You're mm-hmm. helping... It's helping us see our own investment in the stereotypes. And so this project really did a nice job of pulling that up.
Excellent. Excellent job.
Right?
And now, then, can I ask this class a question? The young ladies in the class. What did you guys learn about yourselves in terms of stereotypes and doing this project? What did you find out maybe in terms of your own implicit bias?
Yeah, the whole class.
So, I mean, one of the things that we...
give your name.
I'm Gabriel, and one of the important things that that I guess we learned in this class is the fact that every individual has bias, and it's human nature to hold and maintain bias, but when those biases hinder or affect the relationships that we create between human beings, such as racial relationships and things of that nature, it's important for us to be aware of them and to be cognizant of them so that we can best promote better interactions between human beings, because that's what it's all about. Essentially, we're trying to create a community or a society in which we want to live in and sustain ourselves and do forward thinking and not have to worry about the color of one's skin or things of that nature. And what we have to learn as individuals is that we maintain some of these biases and be cognizant of them so that we can alter our behavior to adapt to a better community.
Thanks, Gabriel. Nice.
Thanks, Gabriel. Very good.
Yeah.
Can I get someone else? Don't have to pick people out. I'll pick people out. The young man in the back there. on my right-hand side, wearing the jacket.
Yeah, that's you. You're trying to hide. Toby.
Yeah.
What?
Give your name and what did you learn?
I'm Toby. We learned that like everyone has a bias, pretty much. Like we all have our own perception of people, but it's up to us as individuals not to carry on a stereotype. And when you see someone, don't judge them based right off of looking at them. And be stereotypical right off that. Get to know the person and get to know who they are and pretty much see what type of person they are.
Thank you, Tony. The young lady right here. She's in the burgundy.
Burgundy.
On my right hand side.
I think that's you.
Oh, you, in the back.
Yeah. Nope.
Nope, right. Burgundy, red, over to the left now.
Oh.
She's got her head turned.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that is. Oh, yeah. I'm zeroing in here, people. She's trying to act like, oh, that couldn't be me. Stand up, please. Give your name.
Hi, my name is Maria. And, well, pretty much, I guess it's the same thing. We've learned that everyone has their bias, even though they don't want to admit it. So it's kind of like a quote. I think most people have heard of it. Don't judge a book by its cover. It's pretty much the same.
Good. That's good.
Yeah.
Thank you. So what I, I had Dr. Anthony Greenwald on the show, and if you guys have done the research, Dr. Anthony Greenwald, along with his research partner, created the implicit association test, which is now over 30 years old.
Wait a minute.
In that test, pretty much everybody fails, including people of color, that there is a bias towards race. And so that it's free. It's in a Harvard study, but you can go on. I forgot. I'll put the link up. But it's a Harvard study where you can go and take the test. There it is. Yep, that's it.
We had another group who used the test, offered it to our campus community, and here what I'm holding up for you are some of the results of that test.
Wow.
So the results of the we should have all worn our implicit, our got bias t-shirts. Oh, so we all have these wonderful got bias ? T-shirts that we wore. Oh, wait.
Nice.
Stand up. Here's a sample of our clothing design.
Fantastic.
And you could see got bias. And so, but here's some of the interesting results that we have. We found out on our St. Xavier University campus here in Chicago, that 100% of the European Americans who took the implicit bias test had a preference for European Americans.
Wow.
Of the African Americans on campus who took the implicit bias test, 45% had no preference, 18% had a preference for European American, and 36% had a preference for African American.
Incredible.
So, yeah, so we have more data that included Hispanic, Latino, and then Middle Eastern populations.
Can you PDF that to me?
Absolutely. Well, we'll send it. We'll send you the whole coot and caboodle here. And so, what
the whole shebang, as Dave Chappelle would say.
So, the second part, of course, of the implicit bias is, okay, we got it. Now, what the hell do we do with it? Right now, what do we do? And so, this the next group really sought to tackle that. But let me give you a little more context for their project. They were really concerned, understandably, with what's been happening with police and communities of color. And so what they wanted to dive into was, how could we offer training? What could we do different in terms of police training that might have a positive impact in challenging implicit bias that we all know is there? Everyone has it, right? But it's particularly dangerous to be clueless about implicit bias when you have legal authority to use lethal force. Mm-hmm. And so they, we have two different groups who worked to address training for law enforcement. And let me just explain the two parts before I bring them up here. Part of that educational effort was to use the implicit bias test as a sort of starter to just make everybody aware of where we're at. Mm-hmm. But then the heart of that educational component is how to address it in a really constructive way. And I'll turn it over to them. Kathleen's going to be the spokesperson for that. Okay. And the other educational effort for law enforcement was to really try to help, as part of law enforcement training, help officers understand the link between violence against communities of color and law enforcement. That animosity has been earned.
Mm-hmm.
And to really understand it so that as police try to do their work today, they have an understanding of why they're received in very different ways by very different communities.
Mm-hmm.
And so those were some of the educational efforts. So Kathleen, you want to come on up first? And she's going to bring us into the social science data is what her team focused on to help us challenge implicit bias.
Okay.
Hi, my name's Kathleen.
Hi, Kathleen.
So our group.
I can't see the screen.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Or do you want to? I don't know how you guys want to. Okay, there we go.
On the screen.
Yeah. Okay. So our group did implicit bias, and we were like defining it first and how it refers to like stereotypes that affect our understanding, but we don't really have like control over it. So what I did was I found a social research study on National Center for Biotechnology Information, and it was called Long-Term Reduction in Implicit Race Bias, a Prejudice Habit-Breaking Intervention by Devine. And what it said was that there's a difference between explicit and implicit bias, where explicit bias is context independent and can be easily changed. Implicit bias is more like, has more context to it, and it also requires more time, effort, and intensity of experience to change. So what the study did was that they had two groups, and one group had training and strategies offered to them to reduce bias, while the other group had none of these. And their main goal was to reduce implicit bias, increase one's concern about discrimination, and increase one's personal awareness of bias.
Fantastic.
And for the implicit bias, they thought of it as a habit, like that one can decrease. And at the end of the study, those that had the strategies gained an awareness of their biases, felt concerned about their consequences of their biases, knew what their biases responses, like, they're likely to occur, and also acknowledged how one could replace these with non-biased responses. And so now I'm going to go over, like, the strategies that they produce, and it's what we thought that the police department could use to also reduce their implicit bias. There's the stereotype replacement, and it's replacing one stereotypical responses for non-stereotypical responses. So you recognize that the other person, for example, an African-American, usually there's a stereotype that they're like uneducated, dangerous. So you take that upon yourself and you change that to a more unbiased stereotype, and you also determine the cost of this response. The second one that they did was the counter-stereotypic imaging. And it's similar in that it replaces the biased response with an unbiased response, but it also involves more like counter-stereotyping others. Individuation is preventing stereotypes by like obtaining specific information about other members. So instead of group-based or societal attributes on the stereotypes they're given, you evaluate them based on your personal experience. Perspective taking is more in increasing psychological closeness, because when you put yourself in that person's like shoes, you get more reading on how like it really affects them in their life. And then there's also the increasing opportunities for contact, because once you seek more opportunities to encounter and engage in positive interactions with others, you're more likely to lessen your implicit bias.
Fantastic.
Thanks.
That's incredible. Thank you for that.
So we lost a bunch of our class because they have another class to go to, but there is...
I was going to say, what happened?
Yeah.
That was like 1 minute they're there and the next minute they're not. I'm like, whoa, wait a minute.
So if we have time, there's two other... I'm going to leave off the historical information part of the project for law enforcement, especially since you and I can talk about it later, but
sure.
But really include historical material that help that no law enforcement officer should enter the force and not really know some of the history that directly links law enforcement with violence against people of color.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the other part of it. But right now I'd like to share with your listeners another project, and that is these folks wanted to take the Black Lives Matter yard signs,
mm-hmm.
and saw that really as an opportunity to do a lot more. And so what they've done is they also got this idea because I don't know if y'all have this a lot out in California, but where I am in Evanston, there's quite a few of these libraries in people's front yard where it's sort of this big bird feeder filled with books, and people just come and take them and put ones in, and it's just it's really sweet. So they had me come up with some little kind of front yard library box, but instead of using it for books, we have it next to our Black Lives Matter sign as an opportunity to educate people. Like, why does this house in your neighborhood have a Black Lives Matter sign? Like, what does it mean to us? And so I'll let them come up here and share these cards that they've made that people can come grab and take with them. And I think you'll see pretty quickly what that's about. And if we have time, we also have a letter to National Public Radio asking them to consider a policy that highly recommends that their journalists begin naming white people as white. So hopefully we'll have time to get to that. But now I'm going to turn it over, and y'all begin by introducing yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Alicia.
And
hi, Alicia.
Okay.
Alicia. Okay, Alicia and?
Angelica.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So Dr. Battalora already explained why we did this. So we just wrote that for our free library so everyone knows. And then we got some images. And the first one says, our future leaders And then the historical quote that we used to go with it was, prohibition laws prohibited free people of African descent from holding public office throughout the history of the United States. Africanness was positioned within a social hierarchy being constructed in law somewhere below that of this invented group called whites. And that is from First of a White Nation by Jacqueline.
So then this was our next one. Oh, she's got it. So Bacon's Rebellion represents the unification of laborers of African and European descent, freed servants, freed slaves, and small landowners, which was a threat of a united force to the capitalist plantation system. A divide and conquer approach was created in which they separated laborers by creating one group, which was whites, with the authority to rule over and oppress the other, which were non-whites. And this was from Birth of a White Nation as well.
They're on the payroll, clearly.
Good payroll.
Our next one says that there's a female holding a sign that says pro-black isn't anti-white. And our quote was, what does Black Lives Matter mean? It is a conversation focused on the violence that includes all the ways in which black people are intentionally left powerless at the hands of the state. And that is directly from Black Lives Matter.
Oh, that's excellent.
Yeah.
So the next one was Hands Up, Don't Shoot, which became the slogan of protesters after the fatal killing of Michael Brown in Ferguson. This rallying cry was used because witness accounts spread after the shooting that Brown had his hands raised in surrender, mouthing the words "Don't shoot" as his last words before being shot execution style. The gesture of raised hands became a symbol of outrage over mistreatment of unarmed black youth by police, and this was from the Washington Post in 2015.
The next one, it's another poster that says, they kill all our daddies, then make fun of us for being fatherless, and then it has hashtag Black Lives Matter at the bottom. Wow. What we use is 37% of unarmed people killed by police were black in 2015, despite black people being only 13% of the U.S. population, and that is from mappingpoliceviolence.org.
Excellent. Now, where are these available? Are these available now?
So these will go on a free library outside of Dr. Battalora's house, so anyone who comes by can just take one and they get this information.
We have
wow. We got to figure out how to mass produce that.
That's what I said. That's why I wanted, if any of your viewers.
I'm about to get on a plane and come to your house. I'm just saying.
Well,
I love this. Brilliant.
So this one was like a reinforcement of the Hands Up, Don't Shoot. It says, no one should have to teach their children this in the USA. It became the shorthand for police mistreatment of minorities, one that's spreading beyond traditional protest scenes. It has evolved into a national movement with demands centered on changing what some see as systemic problems in law enforcement that lead to mistreatment of minorities. Protesters, pro athletes, Broadway performers, and congressional staffers have used the gesture in public in a show of solidarity. And this was from CNN.
Wow.
This is our second to last one. This one is of a woman outside of a protest, and her sign says, yes, all lives matter, but we are focused on black ones right now, okay? Because it is very apparent that our judicial system doesn't know that. Plus, if you can't see why we are explaining Black Lives Matter, you are a part of the problem. And the quote that goes with that is, Black Lives Matter is working for a world where black lives are no longer systematically and intentionally targeted for demise. And that is from Black Lives Matter.
This was our last one. Says, well, I think that all lives matter. We should care exactly equally at all times about everything, like all houses matter. Presumptions that white people are law-abiding, a good credit risk, trustworthy, or American are presumptions that shape the very organization or structure of policing, law, lending, neighborhoods, and more, and as a result, confer white privilege today. U.S. law enforcement officers killed up to about 2,000 people last year, the majority of whom were people of color. According to the open source reporting project called Killed by Police,
Black men between the ages of 15 and 34 were 15% of those killed, despite making up just 2% of the population. That's 5 times more than white men the exact same age.
So, Philippe, I have a professor who has a class to run.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you very much. Give yourselves a round of applause there. That's awesome.
So, if we're going to do our best to share this as widely as possible. So if people are interested in info, my email address, Philippe, can share with you, Battalora at SXU, as in St. Xavier University, .edu. I'm happy to share anything you'd like to know. There's another document I didn't get a chance to read that is also really important part of these projects, and that is the one I mentioned, the open letter that will get posted to National Public Radio, inviting them to consider a policy that encourages their journalists to intentionally be conscientious about naming white people as white.
Now, in our last conversation, you and I, Doc, we had this conversation about naming white. I absolutely loved it. For this audience that's watching, what does it mean to name white? How do you do it? What's the process of that?
Well, what I do is, for most people, it's something that's a real challenge. It really distorts our common patterns of thinking. So I have people, I gave my students an assignment for a week. Everywhere you go, count the white people. You go into Starbucks, start counting the white people. When you're going into wherever you're going, count the white people. So what's the point? So the reason that you do that is because it'll, and I'm hoping you and I are going to put together one of those small package shows just on this topic, because I'm holding a professor out of his classroom right now, so I have to stop. But there's at least 30 minutes of really important information related to why we must start naming whiteness. And the ultimate point is that when we're not naming the whiteness of white people, we are inadvertently affirming white superiority.
Mm. Right? I like that.
I have to get out of here. Thank you to the listeners. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Doc. Thank you to the students. Tell them they were absolutely awesome and wonderful. Of course, you'll be able to watch this again and again on our YouTube channel. Thanks for tuning in wherever you are around the world. We'll see you next time, ladies and gentlemen, on the Philippe Matthews Show Live.